made it, had his diner here. Of course, then they had this other place here too. George Homa owned that too, didn't he? One time ago? Yeah, George Homa owned that too. But years before, there was a big ditch on the other side of this building here, the Foxwood, whatever it said. Diner, not a diner, this is a tavern, yeah. Red bandana, they call this thing. Is that what it is now?
Every year, Chief.
Yeah, there you are. Right over where that, you see that sign there, the Shell sign? On the other side, there was another place there. It was quite a big place there. It was an open road stand. The Orsic Boys had that. Now, the Orsic Boys, they are located across from the Red Apple Rest in Southfields, right near Orange Road. If you're familiar with Red Apple Rest in Southfields, well, they had their place over there. And on the other side of the street, there was Schnitzer's Texas Wieners, and there was another little road stand there. I can't remember the man's name that had it, but Frank the Pollock worked for him. Also, there was a big field out here, right across from where the Mahwah Diner is here, and they had carnivals. All the carnivals that were in Mahwah were held in this field over here, except two that were across from the basket factory on North Ramapo Avenue. That's on the west side of the railroad tracks. They had two carnivals. I'll tell you about them later if I don't forget.
That's where the bus garage is now.
Right, that's right. Where the garage itself is, is where the carnival
was
held. Yeah, big carnival.
Didn't they used to hold, Mahwah Alliance hold their carnival about 20 years ago at that point when they were going to build the, expand the present Mahwah Shopping Center?
That's up above. That's quite a ways up above.
I know, that's up above.
Yeah. I can't remember that. But the Ward had also had a construction outfit. It was kind of low. There was a big hole down in there. And he went quite low and had all his equipment hidden in the ditch, like, sort of. You couldn't see it. I guess he didn't want anybody to, mess up the area. Well, anyway, carnivals were held here. Two carnivals were held, of course, in the basket factory. I'll show you that later on in one of my slides. Now this is going into baseball. This is Johnny Warhol, and this is the old Ramsey High School in Ramsey. Now Warhol was quite an accomplished baseball player. He also had a few teams. He was one of the organizers of some good baseball teams in Mahwah. All-Stars. Swan played for him, Stuart Swan. What's his name? Chick Haight played for him. Yeah, Chick Haight. And there was his brother, Fred. Oh, they were great baseball players. Al Winters, he played there. His brother, Toot Winters. Ted Twilliger played. This is Swan now. He's playing for, this is Stuart Swan, and that's him when he played for American League. Anybody know him?
Yeah.
This was in the 30s, early 30s. Yeah, he was someplace. He was Glen Idol. Yeah, he's in his 90s right now, and he's in pretty good shape. Stuart Swan, here he is right here. He lives on Inside Avenue. There he is here. This looks like Morris. This looks like Chick Haight here.
That's Chick.
I don't know who the rest of them are. This might be, I don't know, it might be Fred, because Fred was a good catcher. Here's another team. It was in 1940, of course. Steve Washdog, Tony Possum, we call him, Panineski. This was Steve Dombrowski. That's my brother, August. That's Kneffel. And this is Tony New York, isn't it? George Mayhawk, Tony Janosko, Adam Selesky, Timko, George is it? Zach, and John Kirai, John Kopinski, and Victor Poplowski, the manager. They had a pretty nice team, 1940. Now here's something that's very interesting. This is It Breaks You Old. Now, right here, where this arrow is pointing now, was the Johnson House. this is the road underneath the railroad that goes into the Suffolk. This is going north on 202, and you go underneath the railroad bridge here. Matter of fact, that's where the trolley went on the right-hand side, up this way to Suffolk. Now, Basket Factory was right here at this intersection. Right here, this intersection is where the Basket Factory was. Now, this road is Johnson Avenue today. Carnivals were right in over top of where this road is, where the sidewalks, where it was only a gravel road, not a gravel, but a black cinder road. And the carnival was in this area right here, two carnivals. There was one was a Captain Worley, he was a diver, he used to dive in a net. And then there was a lady diver by the name of, I can't remember her name anyway. It's in here. Well, let's forget that name. I'll have to go looking for it. That's not that important. Now, you see where Catherine Avenue is in here? Right about here was a cemetery. There was a Johnson and Wanamaker Cemetery. It was right here. That disappeared. Believe me, nobody even knew how fast it disappeared. It just disappeared. And it was on the side of the hill there, the big sandbank. And today they cut a road in there. It never was a road. They cut the road in there. They cut the sandbank down and everything. They filled in the whole swamp. And they made extra land in there all the way up the river. And that's probably what some of the flooding is all about today.
Is that where...
I would say, never mind.
That
was the name I had in those days. Man swimming there. That was the way it was. You asked me. If you asked directions, you wanted to know where something was happening, you'd ask by these names, and everybody knew where they were. Otherwise, you just wouldn't know. But anyway, let me put it this way. There was a path right over here from near the Johnson house here across Cheers Field to the Brake Shoe. Well, this path later on, after Frank Scherer built 14 houses in there, and built a lot of roads in there. That pathway came went all the way up to, let's see if I can find it. Jersey Avenue, right here, the kids. The kid family used to walk this road and go through this path that was along here and come up this way here and then follow, get on Long Avenue or Lamero Avenue and go all the way down and hit that path and go to school. There's a school here all the way from the New York State line. Well, that was quite a walk. This over here, the Johnson track, they had a horse track there. There was a baseball field here, a grandstand over here, which you'll see. And of course, as I told you, there was a basket factory over here.
Where did that basket factory function?
It's still there. Pardon?
That's when, American Auto Body now.
American Auto Body is there now.
Yeah, but when did the basket factory function?
Basket factory came in the late 20s, I'd say the middle 20s, and they had two fires there. One fire wiped out the not only the dry house that kept the baskets, but it also wiped out the building that had the steam ovens and the ones that cut the logs and peeled them and did all of their work, you know, the machines and all. But then they rebuilt it, and the second one burnt about 1935, I think. It was about 1935 that the second time it burned. It was only the dry house that burned, and I'll show you. Well, see, now here's something here, too. There's a hay field over here. See, this road here used to go across. This is Hoopencroft Road. This follows into the Hoopencroft where the Ford plant was, and today there's Sharp in there. The bridge is over here across the Ramapo River. But this hay field belonged to Al Winter. And there was a barn in here. That burned down. I remember. I was only about
the foundation.
Yeah, the foundation is still standing there. And this oval is not the right scale. I don't know who made this drawing. The lots are at scale, but this drawing is out of scale. It didn't extend as far as it did over here. It extended only to the property line right about where my arrow is pointing. On back like this here. It was a little narrower than that. But Don Bosco, in other words, in 1915, the Salesian sisters and the Don Bosco with the Father Padalong was given permission to operate this, they can't let them use that free. And a big house over here, free of charge. They had church there. There was a butcher shop in there. There were bowling alleys in there. They sold liquor in there. There was everything just about. That thing was a whole town of West Mahwah at one time, because there was no church in West Mahwah back then, 1915.
How big was the graveyard?
Yeah, 1915. Well, 1900, the Greeks who bought property there. Here's the grandstand up on the oval. This is back when the 1915, when the Salesians and Father Pat Long took over the Johnson House. Here's the Johnson House. It's up there. You remember that, John Helleck?
That was a school,
parochial school in there. In the bottom here, the lower level is where the bowling alleys were, the butcher shop. They had everything in there. And the sisters lived upstairs, and the schools were down in the lower level. That's right now where Johnson Avenue and Meadow Avenue intersect, right here. As a matter of fact, who's that that lives there right now? Bowman lived right on that corner, yeah, right here. That house is gone, of course, a good many years. There was another house that was here that contained some blacks that were housed by the American Breakthrough during a 1920 strike. They brought them, imported them from the South, and they lived in this house right about here where this arrow is, and that burned down. So then they housed them within the confines of the plant. That's a different story itself. The Breakthrough is a complete story all by itself, believe me. It's a long story, but a very interesting one. You want to see it again someday? Maybe I'll come back and show it. This is Jack Warhol, 1918, delivering alcoholic beverages for Frank Scherer, the hotel. This was before Prohibition. This was legal. Yeah, and this fella here is my sister-in-law's brother. That's Stanley Checklick. And that's Warhol. Warhol lived in a house. I'll show you where he lived before he built his place up there on the corner of Island Road in 202. Now this little house here is on Breakthrough Place. Back there's the foundry. Now you watch what you're going to see next. It's quite interesting, believe me. Wrong button. There's that house. That wagon was right here in front of it. There's the house, little cottage, a little garage here, clothes on the line, Breakthrough back here. This is Willie Knuffel. He's how old now, would you say? Both?
I don't know.
He's about 60 at least right now. And there was a big rock here, and Janosco's built their lunchroom and tavern next to this. You'll see a little more on the next one. This is going back a piece. Now this here is Sunset Lake. There's the Mullen Barnes. There's Mullen Barn Barnes. There's a house there that Suckerman lives in. And this here, I think, is one of the Remo girls. It looks to me. Wouldn't you say that?
Yeah.
And Route 17 was in already. It was back there. It didn't affect it. I think McKee's probably might have had something to do. I'm not sure. This was on Weno Lake. You know where Weno Road is? Malcolm Road? It sort of disappeared. But here's where all the fireworks were held. Every 4th of July and all potato sack races, all big doings. That's a Betsy Ross school. But this was the lake. This is the south part of the lake. And here's where I used to catch all those nice golden carp. A pound and a half to 2 pounds apiece. We were catching them left and right over here, never realizing that they were imported from Germany. They were German golden carp. Boy, they're beautiful. And there was a boathouse here on this end here. You'll see a picture of it. And part of the lake. I couldn't locate my other slide. I had another slide of a Weno Lake other than this one here. But it's coming. What this is on Franklin Turnpike, on the right-hand side, you'll see these two walls. Now, this company was pretty nice and saved a little bit of the past. Because, well, looking at them here, you can't tell, but you see the walls. When you ride by, look at these two walls here with the plaques in it. Now, here's what it says. Tower Hall, 1906. That was a dairy. As a matter of fact, that dairy, Tower Hall, supplied this school here with all its grade A raw milk for a long time. And then their Raya is today, the concrete, is it? Is that the way it's
Raya?
Well, Ward had that first. The Ward brothers had it as a sand pit. And then Sam Brain got it, and they start going south, and they finally got the Tower Hall. They they destroyed it. Well, they bought the place out, I guess. Took all the sand, and you see nothing there, but now that factory that's there, whatever it is, yeah. And the stone silo was gone. It was a long dirt road that went from the Franklin Turnpike. You went in about a good, I'd say 200 yards, and it was on top of a hill. It was a beautiful big hall, a large house there. Let's see what we have here. I've got to hit the right button. Here is your basket factory, as it is today. That's where the steam room was, and they cut the logs out here. The logs were cut here in the back, rolled in here. When they were cut the sides, they peeled them. They put them in this big steam oven, like a box. They steamed them for I don't know how many hours. And then they put them on a machine, like a lathe, and they peeled it like paper. And then all of the peelings, the sheets of wood, were on a large table that were stamped out into staves of baskets. And in here, in this section, was where the machines were. Let's see, how many machines do you remember? There was four. Was there four machines? Yeah. Earl Orville, the Wanamaker, worked there. Joe Binko, Andrew Binko. And also Belhagen. That's four machines. That's right. And in the section over here, the little section here was a little machine. They used to make hoops. You had to make one single hoop because they couldn't feed the machine that hoop. It had to be in its hoop form instead of a long strand of wood. And so somebody had to make them. And as kids, we used to do piecework. Before we went to school, we'd go over there and make a few hundred of them. And you got paid by the piece. Yeah, it was money. Instead of delivering papers, you went out there and you stamped out a few of those hoops and put in, you know, counted them and all. And these fellows had to use them. And then when they made the baskets, they carried them over here. The dry house was here. It was three stories high. And this was the office. Kinsey Apricar started this business. And then his son, Martin Apricar, ran that business until the last fire. And that was the end of that. It was in the early 30s when that burned down. About 35, I guess, when it burned down. Or before that, 34. Pretty close to that. And they sold craft that worked in here, knitting goods and stuff like that in later years. Grace Apgar, I think, still owns this place, if I'm not mistaken.
No, he doesn't.
The guy bought it.
He bought it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh. Part of this is in New York State, and part of it is in Jersey here. The line goes at an angle here. And there's a mile marker over here at where Fogel used to live. His house was there. Jimmy Fogel's house. You can still see it by the sidewalk in his edges, the mile marker. Now, this house was never here. It wasn't built here. This house was moved from across where North Island, North Railroad Avenue intersects with 202. This was a dry goods store. It was a shoemaker shop. It was a church, a Holy Rollers or something of that sort that used it. Stinky Dombrowski's shoe store started in this building when it was up on 202.
Where's it now?
Warhol bought it and he moved it down here and made a family house out of it.
But where
is it now?
That's Catherine Avenue. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. This is, I'm so sorry. Now, Catherine Avenue, you know where Catherine Avenue is, right? Okay, long time on that. So then we'll go to the next one. Not too far from there, you're going to see a very interesting house. Beautiful picture of it, too. This is the Remo house today, as it looks. This was a speakeasy. It was the only building in the whole area here. and this was a store. Well, we had another store before this store was opened up into the house. There was a store out here, it used to be a road stand out on 202. You'll see a picture of it. And that was our store. But you see where this house is in the background is where the bakery was. It's not there anymore. It was a great big brick oven that had over 300 and some loaves of bread in the back. But that's gone, and they built a house on that same property, those two lots here. Now this house has an interesting history. Most of the lumber that's in this house was from an eight family house up on Island Road, right in the backyard of where John Ostrowski lives. That's where Sherwood Avenue comes out on Island Road. Well, right across, you still see the foundations protruding from the ground in his lawn in the back. They used to call that the Castle Garden. Yeah, that's what the natives called it. The late family household, lumber was put into this house and built this house. Warhol lived in this house before he moved up and bought his place there. That's how this house was built, before my time, about 1915, I guess. 14 or 15. No, it had nothing to do with the brake shoe. Neither did this house. It had nothing to do with the brake shoe. And the house across the street had nothing to do with the brake shoe. And the one in the corner, nothing to do with the brake shoe. That was the house that was on the corner, I'll show you a picture of it. It was on the corner, it was built by Vitro Kalischak. Now he built this house here too, that my father bought in 1917 from him. And this was a two-family house. Now, when we bought that house, it was a two-family house. On this side here was another family, Valesky. It was, I forget his name, I think his name was Stanley. Valesky, he was a baker. And they had a boarder that lived with him named John Kruger. And we occupied this side of the house. Well, they talked my parents into building a bakery in a second lot in the back in 1917. And finally, my folks agreed, and they built the bakery and leased it, since the one that rented the half of his house was a baker. John Cooper was a salesman, and his wife was the operator of the business, the paperwork. And so for 3 years, that's from 1917 to 1921, they operated it. And they got arguing amongst themselves, and things didn't work out. So an agreement was made that my folks would take the business over. So in 1921, Louis Trusewicz and Anna Trusewicz, my mother and father, took over the business. My father became the salesman, the driver. My mother ran the business as far as running the business, and raised seven children too while doing it. And we had our store over here on this side here. It was a tin building, you'll see it. The bakery oven was a very large brick oven. It, at one time it could hold 325 loaves of the large sandwich loaves. And one of our customers was at Red Apple Rest in Southfields. They used to order anywhere from 150 to 200 loaves at a time on a Saturday or a Sunday. We got the bake special for them every once in a while. Of course, then we had to get another baker because this baker, I don't know why, but he left. And we had a baker by the name of Chahosky. And we had another baker, a secondhand baker, that had to help him. My father ran the truck. And then later on, we got another truck. The other truck was run by John Mahwah. So we had two trucks running a route, and we had others working on a 30% commission that would buy rolls, bread, and cakes, and have routes. Our routes extended all the way to Southfields, Tuxedo, and that area, Ringwood Mines, all the way to Haverstraw, Stony Point, the Brickyard, especially up there, Garneville, and then up in Spring Valley, Muncie area, Nanuet, Park Ridge in that area, and the farms around Mahwah, Allendale, and all these areas, and it's Mahwah also. Now this here is a little store. in this building here. There was a sign where my arrow is here, candy, cigarettes, and soda. And the store, here's the entrance to the store. It was a lower level here. It was operated by many. Sheila lived in here, too. He owned this at one time. And it was sold, changed hands many times. Seal Kamefov owns it now. The Hellick family lived upstairs in this house. John's here tonight. Right, John?
Right.
And Laura lived in this house, and then the Zaccaronis lived there later years. What's his name? Czechlicks lived up there, and Hank Mann lived
there. Two apartments in that house?
Four.
Four
families, you know?
Is that on 202?
Pardon?
Is that on 202?
No, that's right off at 202, in front of the break, at Breach Gate. Door gate is here, the gate right here. It's at the bottom of the hill. You'll find George and World's Tavern right here. Eddie's, it's called Eddie's today. Right across from the main entrance in Great Shoe, right in here. Of course, the only two houses that had electricity at that time was this house and here. We had to have a special pole put over here for electric to run the machines. But in the early days, they mixed the dough by hand. They didn't have machines in the early 18 and in the early 20s, you know. Electricity was,
Mark, can I interrupt you for a minute?
Yes, please.
I told a lot of people that Pop never put license plates on that truck from the beginning, that he rode his routes without license plates on it. Nobody wants to believe
that. That's a fact. That is a fact. He had forgotten what he used to do. He used to take the plates off the truck and put them on his 1921 Touring. And he'd go out, we'd get trips on Sundays, and he'd forget to put the plates back on the truck. You weren't supposed to have commercial plates anyway on a passenger car, but he didn't know, I guess. But he did it through Spring Valley, suffered there. Nobody stopped him.
No,
wouldn't Judge Price love to get that? Well, this is Kashmir Kanepa. Well, this is a familiar sight in those days. That's a little pretty.
Favorite Halloween spot.
Yeah. Every Halloween, that was down the bank here. Down by the river, the animal tree. Well, that's the breakthrough water tank there. And this is a part of the old building here where they housed the blacks in 1920. Yeah, that was a camp they called that. That was about 60 feet long and about 40 feet wide. There was a hallway all the way through, and it had compartments where they had, on both sides, where they had their sleeping quarters and some sort of a bureau or something. And the kitchen right here, the stairs went up into the kitchen. They had one man doing the cooking for all the men here. Also, they had them in a building that's over here in the break shoes. That's this building here. It's on the other side. I don't want to go into this break. That's not the story. It's by itself. So I'll let that go. But this house burned down. This is the second building. The first one burned down in 1915. The Czechlick family lived upstairs. They moved out. There used to be a barber shop in there. And then this was rebuilt about 1917, 16 or 17. They rebuilt it. And Paul Janosko had a lunchroom there until Hornyak, Steve Hornyak, operated for a while.